Welcome to Cine Series Recap. Enola Holmes dashes through Victorian London's congested streets, chased by two police officers. Enola addresses the crowd as they corner her in a back alley to explain the issue. We take a step back in time. Enola has plans to open her own detective business after solving the case of Lord Tewkesbury of Basilweather's abduction and attempted murder. She hires a tiny office space in London, places ads in the media, and is ready to go. Nevertheless, none of her prospective customers are interested in letting a young girl handle their problem, and the Tewkesbury disappearance is widely assumed to have been solved by Enola's elder brother, the eponymous Sherlock Holmes. Sherlock himself, despite a consistent run of solved cases, is said to have been perplexed recently by a stunning spate of crimes. Eudoria Holmes, Enola's mother, has been causing her own havoc by dropping small, very innocuous bombs into postal pillars stuffed with pamphlets for women's suffrage. However, Tewkesbury has established himself in the House of Lords as a voice for constructive change, and he has garnered support as a reform champion among both the government and the public. He's also been writing to Enola, who plainly has love for the young lord, but remembering her mother's old instructions to forge her own path and reject what society throws at her, she resolves to ignore his letters. Enola's business appears to be a failure as the months pass. She starts collecting her belongings to go when her first genuine customer, a 10-year-old match girl called Bessie, walks into her agency. She came to beg Enola to find her sister after seeing one of her previous adverts indicating that she specialized in discovering missing people. Bessie drives Enola to her slum tenement, where she and her sister, Sarah, reside in a small room in the building that houses all of the neighborhood match girls. Sarah is described as an older female with red hair. Seeing the dissimilarity, Bessie and Sarah's friend, Mi, informs Enola that the two were discovered sisters, and Sarah took in the younger daughter. Enola looks about the room, discovering various potted plants, some of which have perished, science books, and a small collection of cosmetics, which is unusual for a single girl her age. She also discovers that Sarah loved to leave cheese out for the rodents, despite Bessie's claims that she is gentle on them. Enola glances around and notices a half-burned paper, the sole remaining bit of which reads the 12th of March. Mi opposes Enola's investigation and attempts to persuade her to quit, but Bessie persists on employing the lady investigator. Bessie informs Enola that she last saw Sarah a week ago at the match factory when she was involved in a confrontation with the foreman, who claimed she had stolen something from his office. Sarah had only left the small money she had earned from her two jobs, the match factory and cleaning glasses at a tavern, for Bessie. Bessie wants to hand over the money to Enola, but she refuses until she has solved the riddle and agrees to take the case. Bessie disguises Enola and takes her to Lyon's match factory with the rest of the working females. Mr. Crouch, the foreman, examines them for indications of typhus, which has broken out among the girls working at the factory as they enter, Enola giving a false identity. Bessie shows Enola Sarah's workstation, and the investigator notices that any mistakes are deducted from the girl's pay. She breaks into Crouch's office and discovers an old pack of matches soaked in red phosphorus, as opposed to the white matches they are currently using. She also breaks into the safe and discovers a strand of red hair in a ledger with many pages ripped out. She flees when she overhears Mr. Lyon, the company's owner, and his son William discussing the theft with another affluent man and his assistant. Lyon takes the other man, Lord McIntyre, on a tour of his factory as they depart, just missing Enola herself. Lyon shows off his hardworking lady, many of whom know someone who is dying or has died from typhus during the previous 2 years as it has spread through the match girls. Enola deduces from Bessie that Mi previously assisted Sarah in sneaking into Crouch's office by causing a fire at her station, and she resolves to follow her that evening. Despite her best efforts, Mi brings Enola to the Paragon, a downtown theater. Enola spots Mi among the other dancers as she swings to the stage on a trapeze. During the performance, Enola returns backstage and is approached with a knife by Mi, who cautions her that a posh girl like her should not be engaged. Enola demands to know what was in the pages Sarah took from Lyon after displaying her powers by turning the table and pinning Mi, having surmised from the makeup in her flat that Sarah and Mi both acted at the theater and lied about it to Bessie. Sarah is summoned back to the stage, where she explains that the knife was actually a prop. Enola blackmails the stage manager into showing her Sarah's cosmetics station. He informs her that Sarah had a romantic interest in a Gentile man who sent her flowers and notes. Enola discovers one of the concealed letters, which contains a poem inscribed with what appears to be a poppy. She begins to think that Sarah has fled with, or is fleeing from, a boyfriend. Enola learns she is being followed by a guy wielding a cane with a metal point as she makes her way back. She manages to avoid him and comes to Sherlock, who has just been booted out of a pub. They are surprised to see each other, and Sherlock is heavily inebriated, which he excuses as being a part of his latest case. Enola assists her brother's return to 221B Baker Street, and she is amazed to finally be inside the famed, albeit exceedingly dirty, flat. Before passing out, Sherlock urges her not to touch anything, and she chooses to look around. She discovers evidence of his most recent case, a convoluted network of a map depicting hundreds of interconnected crimes. Sherlock gets furious the next morning when he notices she has moved numerous of his files and wants her to leave. She proposes he find a flatmate to keep him from sliding into the state of disarray and inebriation in which he has recently found himself. When they quarrel, Sherlock deduces from her look and overall state that she has worked in a match factory, observing the mark on her neck from Mee's knife. Wonders whether she is in danger. He encourages her not to get herself into trouble in order to prove herself, and that his offer to make her his ward is still open. Enola departs, insisting that she does not require his permission or assistance. She storms out to the park, but is cut short by the appearance of Tewkesbury on his regular stroll to the House of Lords. Enola compliments him on his job and notes that he is now regarded quite an eligible bachelor by the social papers, but he advises her not to believe it. He says he has seen her in this park every so often on his way to the Lords, and she brushes it off saying that she likes to enjoy her breakfast there sometimes. When questioned why she did not respond to his letters, she claims she was too preoccupied with beginning her own business. He offers to assist her financially if she requires it, but she declines. Tewkesbury continues on his journey, telling her she knows where to find him. Enola relaxes and informs the audience that she does not always come to the park while Tewkesbury is commuting. However, she inadvertently admits that she knows all of his normal routes. Enola, suddenly inspired, reads Sarah's lover's poetry and discovers a coded address in the lyrics. Following it, she comes to an apartment with the door pushed open. Heading upstairs, she discovers the flat in ruins, with evidence of a redhead lady and a male living there. Glancing around, she discovers Mee on the bed, barely alive, with a knife embedded in her stomach. Enola attempts to stabilize her, but she bleeds out. Enola is taken aback when she realizes Mee indicated her pocket before she died, and she uncovers a piece of sheet music titled The Truth of the Gods. Inspector Lestrade walks in, quickly followed by his supervisor, Superintendent Grail, whose cane produces the identical clanging sound Enola heard following her the night before. Grail and Lestrade assume Enola murdered Mee after discovering blood on her hands and evidence she attempted to conceal. Not trusting Grail, Enola flees the police and returns to Sherlock's flat before Lestrade arrives to check about her location. Sherlock successfully conceals her, and the siblings then share case facts. The older Holmes adds that a series of brilliant financial robberies have occurred around London and are being siphoned into a single untraceable account, and whomever is behind it is a genius who is clearly having fun. His sole lead is a hazy description of a guy taking a document from the Treasury Department. Holmes orders Enola to remain at his flat while he goes out to investigate.
Enola, I know you're not a fan of unnecessary advice, but please.
When he is away, Enola conducts research and discovers an article about an upcoming gala being thrown by Mr. Lyon to battle typhus among matchmakers. She recalls her talk with Tewkesbury and recognizes that the flower on Sarah's message is a sweet William, as in Mr. Lyon's son William Lyon, and plans to infiltrate the ball. Enola successfully enters the party, but she is not permitted to talk with William without a chaperone. Disappointed, she is contacted by Mira Troy, Lord McIntyre's personal assistant, who gives her a fan that can be used to communicate in hidden languages. Enola's sole chance of getting near to Lyon's heir without an escort is by dance, something her rebel mother never taught her. Enola comes upon Tewkesbury, drags him into a restroom, and demands an impromptu dancing instruction from the befuddled nobleman. When she tells him that a girl's life may be in danger, he grudgingly accepts, and as they proceed through the stages, they express their mutual worry for each other's safety, since he has noticed her keeping tabs on him for months. They get closer together as Enola picks up the dance, but are stopped by a knock on the door. Tewkesbury hands Enola a dance card and goes via the window, leaving Enola with a fan flourish, the significance of which he promises she will ultimately discover. Enola gets William to sign her dance card, and his writing matches the message, proving he was Sarah's boyfriend. Lady Sisley, another woman at the event, approaches Tewksbury, much to Enola's chagrin. The next dance begins, and Enola uses the chance to speak with William about Sarah, fearing he merely pretended to love her in order to injure her. He becomes terrified when she says this, admitting that he knows Sarah's sister Bessie, and begs her to leave it alone for the sake of both of their safety. When Enola refuses, he tells her she must meet with him later to explain. When she arrives, she finds Tewksbury there, trying to care after her, and they dispute, Enola presuming Tewksbury's only concern is finding a wife among his many admirers. As William comes, he recognizes Tewksbury, but they don't have time to converse since the police arrive and arrest Enola. Before being transported to Scotland Yard and questioned by Grail, she slips Tewksbury her proof. Enola deduces that he has been monitoring her and me on someone else's behalf. He wants to know where Sarah is, but Enola has no idea. Instead, he threatens to find out from Bessie. Sherlock learns about Enola's arrest and travels to the station to have her released. Grail refuses, despite the fact that Sherlock's deductions from the apartment crime scene indicate that Grail and his personal officers murdered me while seeking for Sarah. Grail has cutting-edge equipment that can establish Enola's guilt, her fingerprints on the knife. Sherlock knows this is impossible because his sister has never handled the weapon.
Especially in a murder case.
So he turns to his mother's friend and judo teacher Edith for assistance. Enola is transported to prison the next day, when she is released by Eudoria and Edith. Who carry her away in a carriage. The hurried mother-daughter reunion is secondary to keeping the pursuing cops at bay with smoke bombs, as Enola explains to Eudoria. Mrs. Holmes advises her just before Grail manages to derail their carriage. The three ladies successfully defend themselves before fleeing under the cover of one more explosion. Before departing, Eudoria tells Enola to use the resources and alliances at her disposal to assist her solve the case, and says that Tewksbury's moral crusading has gained her clear approbation. Enola returns to London to find Bessie and send her somewhere secure to stay. Taking another look around the cramped flat, she notices red and white match heads scattered among the plants and on the cheese Sarah was feeding the rat, noting that everything that has come into contact with the white phosphorus is dead, whereas the more expensive red phosphorus is not nearly as volatile. SH remembers many such trials from the town's love nest, and the puzzle pieces fall into place. The white phosphorus used by the match factory for the previous 2 years is poisonous, and it is killing the girls. To hide it, the manufacturing owners blame it on typhus. Sarah has evidence. Enola locates Tewksbury and requests his assistance, as well as an apology for rejecting him previously. Tewksbury assures her that he has no time or interest in seeking a wife since he is simply too preoccupied with politics to care about anything else. Enola supports him and informs him of the situation. He gives any assistance he can. They are stopped once more by a knock, and Enola hides as Tewksbury responds to discover the woman from earlier, Sisley, who claims she needs to talk with him urgently. He pledges to return later, and she departs. Concerned about what Enola would think, he says that she came to tell him of a scheme involving factory laws. He attempts to express his affections for Enola, but she is too preoccupied with her thoughts to listen. She realizes that Sisley, who also went to the gala without a chaperone, is actually Sarah Chapman in disguise. She dashes outside to attempt to catch up, but Sarah has vanished.
Enola, what on earth?
You were saying that you...
Tewksbury pursues her, agitated, and asks whether she heard anything he was saying. She did, and she questions him about the fan flourish he gave her at the ball. He confesses that it meant I love you. Enola recalls Sisley, Sarah giving William the same flourish at the ball and knows that they were passionately in love, collaborating with me to expose William's own father. Tewksbury was asked to the ball because he was the only guy in government they could rely on to aid them. Enola reveals that she, too, adores Tewksbury and asks him to assist her in completing the case. They slip into the match factory, where Enola meets Sherlock, the core of his investigation also being Lyon's match factory. They discover William dead upstairs, apparently murdered while being questioned. They find a scrap of sheet music in his palm that matches the one Enola discovered on me, the reality of the gods. They race to the Paragon when Tewksbury argues that the gods may be a reference to the upper balcony of a theater. On the way, Tewksbury asks Enola to trade his dance lesson for a fight lesson from her. She teaches him the fundamentals, and they have their first kiss. As they arrive at the theater, Sarah is waiting for them with the paperwork she and William stole demonstrating Lord McIntyre and Henry Lyon plotted to conceal the real cause of death among the match girls, as well as additional evidence placed under the seats in the balcony. The others inform her that William has been slain, But there is little time to mourn as Grail and his men come, holding Bessie captive in order to obtain the papers. Bessie fights back and flees, scattering the gathering. Enola swings from the trapeze to the stage below, but is unable to depart. Grail takes a revolver and shoots Sherlock in the shoulder before chasing Enola upstairs. In the meantime, Tewksbury dispatches Sergeant Beast, Grail's muscular officer, but is fatally outmatched hand-to-hand against the cop. To level the odds, Sherlock confronts the remaining two guys, throwing Tewksbury his cane sword.
Tewksbury!
Enola manipulates Grail to waste his shots, and she succeeds in shielding Sarah and Bessie by drawing Grail into the hanging catwalks high above the stage. Grail takes a knife from the locker area and chases Enola to a dead end before a steep drop. Grail stabs Enola with the knife, causing Tewksbury to become distracted long enough for Beeston to disarm and overpower him. The knife, however, was Mee's retractable prop knife, and Enola flips the script on Grail. He makes an improvised weapon out of an iron hook on a rope and strikes Enola, injuring her head, before taking the documents from her. Using her understanding of cause and effect once more, she leaps from the catwalk, snagging a rope that pulls the hook Grail was using. The hook catches Grail, crushing him against the ceiling before dropping him to the floor. Meanwhile, Tewksbury rallies all of his remaining strength to land a single, tremendous strike on Beast when his guard is down, knocking the officer out in one blow. Sherlock also manages to neutralize the other two guys, reuniting the gang. Lastrade appears with extra cops, sent by Sherlock earlier, to haul away Grail and his paid-off men and prove Enola's innocence. Lord McIntyre, called by Lastrade, also appears with Miss Troy. McIntyre requests that Sarah be jailed for theft and blackmail, yet Sarah has never blackmailed McIntyre or Lyon. Mira Troy, aka Moriarty, is Sherlock's mystery new antagonist, someone fond of mind games and near enough to take advantage of the predicament generated by Sarah, me, and William. She was the one who paid Grail and his men to find Sarah, and they interrogated both me and William, who perished rather than give her up. She blames Grail's brutal ways for their deaths, but she still enjoyed playing the game. Moriarty praises Sherlock and Enola for their efforts, stating they must play again, and is apprehended. Lord McIntyre, on the other hand, takes the documents and burns them, removing the proof of his systematic murder of hundreds of match girls, which devastates Sarah. After a few days, Enola meets with Sarah and Bessie, who inform her that without evidence, the match manufacturers will continue to operate without consequence. Enola joins them in the factory for one more option, and they warn the girls that their only choice is to stand up for themselves and leave the factory until the dangerous white phosphorus is gone. They are cautious at first, fearful of losing valuable revenue, but finally band together and leave the plant in large numbers. Later, Sherlock visits Enola, who has resumed her detective business in Edith's upstairs office, and gives her a newspaper item. Tewksbury has used his clout to get Lord McIntyre, who has been arrested, to testify against him. He also offers her the position of ward and apprentice at Baker Street. While she is charmed and thankful, she rejects, choosing to stay close to the working people and leave the high-profile cases to Sherlock. She does, however, advise him to locate a friend to assist him and alleviate his loneliness. They pledge to check in on one another and make arrangements to meet soon. Tewksbury comes to take Enola out on a date, and Sherlock thanks Edith for her assistance before learning from the newspaper that Moriarty has escaped police custody. Enola and Tewksbury are walking around London when Tewksbury informs her that he has gotten them an invitation to a gala. Considering her previous ball experiences, she proposes seeking an alternative. A few days later, at the appointed hour, Sherlock opens his door to discover, rather than his sister, a Dr. Watson, who had been informed he was searching for a flatmate. He lets the man in after discovering Enola's lie. As we conclude this video, I want to express my gratitude for your time and attention. If you enjoyed the content and would like to see more, consider subscribing and hitting that notification bell.